Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining this webinar. We will just wait a couple of other minutes to give the possibility to everybody to join. Okay, I think that we can start. Hi everybody, welcome and thanks for joining today's webinar. The topic we will talk about today will be probiotics and in particular treatment with probiotics from newborn children to third dentition with implants. And we as Sansar Gamma are very glad to welcome a subject matter expert in this, Dr. Antonio Flicci.
Hello.
Dr. Antonio Flicci is a licensed dentist from the University of Barcelona, and he has a master's degree in oral surgery and implantology from the University of Valencia. And he made remarkable treatments in oral implantology, oral bone surgery and regeneration, maxillary sinus elevation and peri-implantitis treatments. He currently works as a collaborating professor of the Master of Oral Surgery and Implantology at the University of Valencia. And he teaches in the field of oral surgery and implantology in different national and international universities. He's the principal investigator of various studies related to peri-implant crevicular fluid and is the author of numerous scientific publications. During today's webinar, Dr. Flicci will present evidence coming from different studies that probiotics are an important oral care allied in the prevention and treatment of some pathologies. He will explain their use to obtain better oral health in newborn children, to prevent candida, bad breath, and other pathologies in adults, and a therapeutic option for dental implants in elderly people. After Dr. Flicci's presentation, please feel free to write any question you might have in the Q&A section on the right side of your screen, and he will be happy to answer right after. I'm going to hand over here to you, Dr. Flicci, and thanks for your collaboration today.
Hello, thanks for your presentation. And at first of all, I will make to give the thanks to Sansar Gamma for the organization of the webinar, and also to BioGaia to promote the course in the Asia area with Alexander. And now we are going to start to speak about this, of the treatment of probiotics. And I want to explain it from the newborn children, when it's useful for avoid some pathologies, and then in the adult moment with the periodontitis, and finally with the implants, and the literature how exposed us that about the useful of the probiotics in dental implants. I'm going to start it. It's okay for you, Patricia?
Yes, of
okay,
course.
Okay, we continue. One moment, now. At first, we have to make a little introduction about the probiotics. They are live microorganisms that, when are given in enough quantities, produce a benefit of, to the patient, as you know. It was described at first by Elie Besnikoff in 1907, And then the word of probiotics was introduced in 1965. In the market, we can find different options. Now we are going to speak about the one that have more papers published in the literature, is the Lactobacillus rotary prodentis with these two strains. It's very important, the strains. Then we are going to focus in this area of the strains. It's orally, one tablet every 24 hours, every day, during around 28 days for a start to see the results. In the market, you can see the package. In Europe, we have the Gum Sunstar Prebalance. In the Asia and other markets, is the Vivaya for Woman Teeth Prodentis. The probiotics they made different effects. Systemically, we are going to improve the situation of the diarrhea and gastroenteritis or similar pathologies. And in the oral cavity, they are going to create a biofilm in the oral mucosa. They are going to fight, they are going to make a competition with the cariogenic or periodontal bacteria. And also they are going to reduce the halitosis and candida albicans infection. It's very important the mechanism of action of the probiotics for understand why it works and improve the situation of our patients. And they make an action, making a reduction of the inflammation of the patient because they made the inhibition of inflammatory mediators as the cytokines. Also, they enhance of the host immune response because they are going to create this barrier and going to fostering the innate immune response of the patient. And finally, they are going to make an inhibition of the pathogens. They are going to fight with the pathogens, they are going to neutralize the pathogens, and they are going to reduce the risk of infection. This is very important, these three mechanisms of action. Regarding the strains, as I explained to you, it's very important. We are going to focus the attention in these two strains of probiotics. Not all the strains of probiotics are going to give us the same effect. It's very important to understand it. Maybe another Lactobacillus reuteri with other strains maybe make different clinical results, and it's important to give to our patients these probiotics that have more support in the literature with scientific investigation. It's not the same one that the other one. You cannot extrapolate the information of one species of probiotics and say that it's the same effect. We have to understand it is very important. If we talk about pregnancy gingivitis, we are going to start from the mother before the newborn children. We have some papers of Slanhoff. It's great investigation, a good friend, and they made a big and important study. And finally, I summarize it here. They recommend for the reduction of the pregnancy gingivitis, give to the mother two tablets every day during at least four, seven weeks before the delivery, the newborn. Then in other studies regarding the preborn and children treatment, they recommend to give to the mother 1 month before the delivery the Lactobacillus rotary probiotic, and they give them 5 drops every day. And then after the children is born, you have to give to the children 5 drops every day during the first year of his life or the life. It's important to maintain this protocol of 5 drops every day during 1 year, the first year of the life of the newborn. Why? Because it was demonstrated that after 9 years of the follow-up of these people, these children, if they compare with some children that don't take these probiotics, the group of patients that that were taking the drops, the 5 drops every day during 1 year, had less levels of gingivitis and caries. We are going to improve the oral situation of our children only giving them 5 drops every day of probiotics. Normally, I don't know if you have any children, maybe sure, Doctors recommend pediatric doctors recommend us to give to our children some drugs for the stomach, for the gastrointestinal problems, and it's very usual to give them this. Why not to improve also the oral situation cavity and to avoid the problems in the future to our children? Maybe when I will be father in the future, sure, but I will take care about this and I will give to my children these probiotics because it's reinforced by the literature, and for sure we are going to improve the situation of our children. I recommend it because I focus in these papers and I think it's a good option, it's very easy and it's not a problem for the children. Some years ago, 10 years ago, we made a paper, a review, to know the literature about the probiotics in the oral cavity, and we focus in different pathologies. Only for summarize the paper, I put here the effect of different papers and probiotics in the carcinogenic pathogens, and as you can see in this table, in all of them, in all these studies, with the probiotics, we are going to reduce the carcinogenic pathogens and the Streptococcus mutans. There are a lot of literature in this area, it's most studied, and it's sure that we are going to improve the situation in our children regarding the caries pathogens. Why not? Why not we are going to provide this to our children? I think it's a very easy, simple, is an adjacent treatment to the toothbrush and the mouth rinse, and it's very easy for them. It's only a tablet as a caramel, and we are going to improve very good the situation of our patients. With the halitosis, we can check some papers also that they are going to reduce some bacteria that produce a volatile sulfide of Fusobacterium nucleatum, and we are going to reduce the halitosis also. And I think that is important. We are going to improve the situation with our patients. Why not? It's very simple. You have only to take one tablet every day, and it's not very difficult. Also, regarding the Candida albicans, there are some studies that obtain better results that reduce the Candida albicans. Other ones do not obtain the same results. And when we made the guidelines with Sunstar Gum some 2 years ago, I think, we made this recommendation where we recommend 2 tablets every day during 4 weeks for the treatment, and then we add 4 more additional weeks to prevent the recurrence. And if we follow this treatment, we are going to reduce the prevalence of high Candida counts. Now we are going to focus in these 2 tables regarding the caries treatment and the halitosis. There are a lot of papers, a lot of protocols in our guidelines. We recommend to give them at least 3 tablets during 3 weeks. If we give them 3 tablets during 2 weeks, it's not enough time. We are not going to have a good result. At least 3 tablets, 3 weeks. Another option is 1 tablet during 6 weeks or 2 tablets every 12 weeks. It depends on the situation of the patient, the number of caries, the prevalence, a lot of factors. But maybe when I prefer to give them to the children, only 1 tablet is very easy, and you can give it continuously without problems during 4, 5, 6 or more weeks. It's not a problem. And it's more easy to follow this protocol of only 1 every day than if you have to give them 3 tablets every day or different things to the children that they don't want to follow the instructions of the doctor. The most important is not disturb the treatment more than 2 weeks, because in 1 month the beneficial effect of the probiotics is going to disappear. If you have to stop, it's okay, but maybe no more than 2 weeks if it's necessary for patients. It's a complementary aliment. The probiotic is not a problem, it's not a medicine. You can use it continuously without problem. Regarding the halitosis, we observed that when we give them in the studies 2 tablets every 2 weeks, we are going to reduce organoleptic scores, but we are not going to reduce the volatile sulfur compounds levels. In this area, we recommend to increase the number of weeks similar to the cardiac statement, because 2 weeks we think that is not enough. Unless we need 4 weeks for have a real benefit to with our patients, and we need this time for give the probiotic made their work to colonize the area, to make this barrier in the mucosa, and to improve the situation. In some studies, they reduce the weeks, in this case 2 weeks to tablets, but they prefer 4 weeks two tablets or 4 weeks one tablet. It depends on the patient. Regarding the periodontal disease, it's one of the most important areas for patients, because it's in the adult moment of the patients. Here we can observe a lot of literature where they observe that with the probiotics they are going to reduce the clinical indexes like gingival index, PEIC index. Also, they are going to reduce some pathogens, bacteria, as Porphyromonas gingivalis and Prevotella intermedia. Also, they are going to reduce the volume of clavicular fluid. It's very important, the fluid that are between the teeth and the gingiva. It's not saliva, it's the clavicular fluid, or between the implant and the gingiva. And also the cytokines. We can reduce some cytokines with these probiotics. I'm going to focus on with some of these papers. I'm going to explain it now more extensive, but for me are the most important. Why? I'm going to explain later after this slide. Also, we can check a lot of papers in the literature with other lactobacillus that all of them improve the situation of periodontal problems after the use of probiotics, as you can see here. I'm not going to explain all of them, everyone, because all of them observes a good reduction of the bacteria, improvement of the clinical parameters, and we are going to focus with some of them that for us are important. And for example, the three before that I remarked in the first table, one of them was the study of Graves. And why it's important, the study of Graves? Because it was the first one that made a study of probiotics in periodontal problems with the patients, in this case with with moderate to severe gingivitis. And it was casual, because I hear him in a conference in Barcelona some years ago, maybe 12 years ago, I think, or 12 or 11, I don't remember, in a symposium of probiotics in Barcelona. And they explain us that he have a patient that every time that arrives to the dental office for the maintenance of the periodontal problem, never use the toothbrush, never have a good oral hygiene, and always have a disaster of mouth. And in one of these maintenance reviews, they observed an improvement in the oral cavity situation. And the Dr. Craze asked him if he made different things or start to clean the teeth. He said that not, he continued without clean the teeth, and the only thing that he started to take some probiotics for the stomach. And in this way, Dr. Craze started to think about the effect of probiotics in the oral cavity and made this study. This is why I think that is an important study. In this case, they distribute in three groups the patients. It's a good sample with 59 patients, and they give one Lactobacillus reuteri, one strain, another different strain of Lactobacillus reuteri, and the placebo. The parameters that were studied were the gingival index and the bacterial plague. They give them only 14 days, one gum daily. And they observed in the gingival index an improvement in this parameter in the group 1, in the group A, with this strain of Lactobacillus reuteri, better result than in the second one, and better result than in the placebo. And both of them obtain a good result in the plague index control. They reduce the bacterial plague regarding the placebo, that do not observe any difference. This other study, the study of Tweedman was the first one that introduced the evaluation of the cytokines with the use of probiotics to evaluate the useful of the probiotics in the moderate gingivitis. They start with 42 patients in three groups. They give them two tablets, one of them with probiotic and placebo, and the second group probiotic and probiotic, and the third group placebo with placebo. Two tablets every day. They studied the gingival index and also some cytokines like interleukin-1 beta, TNF-alpha, interleukin 6, 8, and 10. They give them 15 days, two grooms daily, and they made some controls at week, 2 weeks, and 4 weeks. What they observed a reduction in the both groups that they take at least one tablet of probiotics, a reduction of the gingival index. But the most important was that only in the group that were taking two tablets every day of probiotics, reduce the cytokines, reduce the levels of TNF-alpha and the interleukin 8. Why it's important? Because we are going to reduce these parameters in the subclinical area. Then I have a video that I'm going to show you for understand all these words of cytokines, interleukins, and the paper of each one in the body. I think that is very clear to for understand the paper of the cytokines. For me, it's one of the most important, this paper of Tweedman, and it's a pleasure to know him. I know him in December last year, and it's a good investigator. A moment that it's not works now. No, sorry, it have a delay. This other paper for me also is very important, the Harini study, where they compare the mouse rings of probiotic with the mouse rings of chlorhexidine. They make three groups with 45 children. The first group is a control group with mentor water. The second group, the probiotic group, and the third group, the chlorhexidine group. They studied the gingival index and the plaque index. The treatment was 14 days, 30 minutes after the toothbrush, 15 millimeters and milliliters, and 60 seconds of the mouth rinse. What they observed? They observed a reduced gingival index in the both groups of probiotic and chlorhexidine, but better result in the group of probiotics. Was a significant difference between the probiotic and the chlorhexidine, and the both one a significant difference with the control that don't have any effect. And in the plaque index, they observe similar results between the probiotic and the chlorhexidine regarding the control group. Why it's important? Because it's not only that we are going to obtain the same result like with the chlorhexidine. In some situations, like in the gingival index, we are going to have better result with the probiotic. And it's important because with the chlorhexidine, as you know, you only can take it approximately during 1 month. It depends on the concentration of chlorhexidine, for avoid some tensions in the teeth and these problems. And also, what do you think that is better in, or well, not now that we are now in our house because of the coronavirus, but what do you think when you are working outside of your work, what do you prefer? To be in the office and have to go to the toilet, use the mouth rinse and do it? Or maybe you are in the street from one side to the other side, you cannot do this with the mouth rinse. If you wear a blister of probiotics in your pocket, it's very simple to take it and you are going to improve the situation. For me, it's very important. I prefer to take a probiotic than use the mouth rinse in the street when I'm outside of my house or the office or whatever. I think it's a good study that reinforces that if we compare with the chlorhexidine, we are going to obtain similar results or better results. Okay. This study of Iniesta is from Spain. I put it here because it's a college from Madrid. They made a study of in 40 studies of dentistry with induced gingivitis. I prefer to avoid the studies with where we have to induce something, because when they are going to start the study, they are going to improve for sure the situation, but they do this. And in one group, they give the probiotic, and in the other group, the placebo. They studied the proven deep bleeding, bacteria charge in saliva, and subgingival plague. They give the treatment around 4 weeks of treatment, 1 month of WhatsApp, and they cross the groups and they start one more time with 4 more weeks with the treatment, one tablet every day. They do not obtain any clinical or microbiological significant differences, but they observed a tendency to the reduction of Orbinomona gingivalis and Prebotella intermedia in the probiotic group. I think that is important because they are dentistry studies. If they are people that are professional from the dentistry, for sure that they are going to improve the situation when they are in the study, because they know how to clean the teeth with the toothbrush and etc. And for sure that we are going to obtain different results and not too much of any difference between the useful or not of probiotics. I prefer some papers that do it in real patients and not in induced gingivitis and not in dentistry students. This other paper of Monica Vicario, also from Barcelona, there is the group of José Nart. They made a study of 20 patients with initial to moderate periodontitis. The first group was with the Lactobacillus rotary and the second group with the placebo. They studied the probing deep, the breathing and the plaque index. And the treatment was 4 weeks of treatment, one tablet every day. And they observed a reduction of clinical parameters in the test group, in the probiotic group, regarding the control group that don't have any differences. This is the line that we find a good result with the probiotic. Now, this paper for me is very important. It was made by Wim Tewals, also a good friend from Belgium. They wanted to evaluate the effect of Lactobacillus rotary tablets as a complement to the root scraping. And they studied the paper with 30 patients with chronic periodontitis. In the first group, they give them a mechanical treatment and a plus of probiotic Lactobacillus rotary treatment. And in the second group, the same, but with placebo. They studied the proving deep, the bleeding, the plaque index, and they made the study, they made the protocol with the probiotics, 12 weeks, one tablet every 12 hours. It was 2 tablets every day, one tablet every 2 hours. It's the first study that do it with 2 tablets every day in the periodontal problems and with a long-term follow-up of 12 weeks taking the probiotics, 3 months. They observed a reduction of the clinical parameters in probiotic group, respect the control group, and also a reduction of the concentration of Porphyromonas gingivalis. Okay, the question is, if you are going to attend to your periodontal patient's problems and you have to make this treatment, the scrubbing, and after this treatment, it's very difficult for you to give them to prescribe it a probiotic. It's very simple. Maybe you prescribe a chlorhexidine. As you know, in the paper that I exposed before, the chlorhexidine and the probiotic had the same effect. Why you have to give them only chlorhexidine? Maybe you can use the chlorhexidine 1 week, and then you can start with probiotics if you prefer. And if we check the literature, as you can see in this paper that was published in the Journal of Clinical Periodontology, one of the most important in dentistry, we are going to improve the situation. We are going to reduce these parameters and we are going to reduce the bacterial charge, the pathogens in our patients. It's very simple, it's very easy. You have to make the hard work in your patient and then only have to prescribe the probiotic. I think it's a good idea, it's a good option, and it's reinforced by the literature, as you can see here. I introduced this new paper that I checked from last year, where the same authors, Wim Tewals, they studied this studied in patients that have the maintenance protocols, the people that come one more time to the maintenance of the periodontal problems, and they put some drops in the pockets after the maintenance during 12 weeks, sorry, they give one tablet every 12 hours. They studied all of these clinical parameters, And they observed that initially they don't observe any effect of the drops, but they observed a good improvement in the reduction of the ProBindip with the probiotic tablets, and do not find in this case microbiological differences. But we, as you can see with this paper, we are going to improve the clinical parameters. It's very important, and sometimes we can find these differences in the microbiological situation. I think it's the line. Why not to use the probiotic tablets 12 weeks, one every 12 hours, two tablets every day. The probiotic drops, we need to make some more papers about this because it's a good idea. I use it, as you can see now later, in some clinical cases, in some patients, but we need more investigation. We need more papers about the useful of drops in pockets and in other situations. But for sure that we are going to find a way to introduce this treatment also. Some other papers, like this one, they made a study in 18 women with one more time induced gingivitis. And I remember you, I don't like this type of papers where you have to induce something. They compared probiotic and placebo. They studied some clinical parameters and also the microbiological parameters, the clavicular fluid, and the cytokines. In this case, they give the treatment 3 weeks, one tablet every 12 hours. And they do not observe any significant differences between the both groups. Maybe because it was a low sample, only 18 patients, and also with induced gingivitis. In this case, when they are going to start with the normal life with the two groups, they are going to improve for sure. But in the literature, always we are going to find some papers that are according with good results and other ones with not differences. It's normal. But in this case, the most quantity of papers demonstrate that with the probiotics, we are going to improve the situation. Maybe one, two, three papers don't think the same and don't obtain these results, but we have to find why they observe different results than the other ones. Maybe because it's an induced gingivitis, maybe the low sample, I don't know. When we made these guidelines, we recommend from people or patients with initial to moderate chronic periodontitis to take two tablets every day during 2 weeks at least, or we recommend 8 weeks. Another option is one tablet every day during 4 weeks at least minimum, or 12 weeks we recommend for maintain and improve better the results. With this protocol, we are going to improve the clinical parameters and also we are going to decrease the bacterial load. With the advanced chronic periodontitis, in this case, we recommend two tablets every day during 4 weeks, but we recommend 12. 4 weeks is the minimum. And we are going to improve the situation. I prefer to maintain 12 weeks as following the paper of Winty Wells. This is the photo or the picture that you have to have in your mind when you have to prescribe the probiotics to your patients. In this table, we are going to summarize. It's very easy. It's not complicated. The use and the posology of the probiotics with all the problems of the oral cavity and different stage of the life of the patients. For example, in the pregnant woman, you know that you have to give them or two tablets or five drops during 4-6 weeks before the delivery for reduced gingivitis. There are no studies in caries, periodontitis, and other problems. In the newborn, you know that for reduced caries, you have to give them five drops during 1 year, and for the gingivitis, the same, five drops during 1 year. And for the children, for avoid the caries, you can give them two tablets during 4 weeks or three tablets during 3 weeks. There are no studies in gingivitis and other problems. For the adult, we can give them, for avoid the caries, two tablets every 4 weeks. During 4 weeks, sorry, or three tablets during 3 weeks. Also for gingivitis, we recommend two tablets during 4 weeks. And for the periodontitis, for the people that have initial to moderate periodontitis, we can give them one tablet every 4 weeks or two tablets during 2 weeks. Another option in the advanced periodontitis, 2 tablets during 12 weeks or 2 tablets during 3 weeks. I think it's, with this tablet you summarize the protocol and you can make the indications to your patients. Now we are going to start with the peri-implantitis, in this case with the peri-implant pathology. As you can check now in some papers, we can give 1 tablet every 4 weeks. For the halitosis, 2 tablets for more than 2 weeks, and for the candida, 2 tablets during 12 weeks. Okay. Additional recommendations for the good useful of the probiotics. We don't have to interrupt the probiotic the first 2 weeks. We need this time for improve and make a stabilization of the situation. We also take the probiotics 30 minutes after the toothbrush. If we have to give them 2 tablets every day, we are going to give 1 tablet in the morning and 1 tablet in the evening, in the night. Also, the patient have to receive the oral hygiene instructions and they have to make the toothbrush 3 times every day. The probiotics is a reinforcement of the for the treatment. We have to reduce some risk of smoking, healthy diet, reduce the stress is typical from other, with the other parameters with the patients that we have to treat. And the most important, if the patients are under chlorhexidine treatment, we, for example, if we made a full mold disinfection in the dental office with a chlorhexidine 0.12%, we have to start with the probiotics the day after of the treatment. If the patients are taking chlorhexidine 0.12% as in a mouth rinse or a toothpaste during 4-7 days, for example, we have to start with the probiotics 2 days before finish, because when they are going to finish the probiotic, the chlorhexidine, the probiotics in the low levels are going to be there to start to colonize the area. If the patients take chlorhexidine 0.06% in the mouth rinse or toothpaste during the month of maintenance, they can take probiotics daily at least 4 hours after the chlorhexidine maintenance. In my opinion, I think there are another options. If we need to give them chlorhexidine punctually in a moment, we can do it. But as a maintenance, maybe we have other options to avoid the chlorhexidine. And you can use the probiotics that have the same effect or sometimes better results. Okay, we're going to talk now about the clavicular fluid. I don't know if you know what is that. The clavicular fluid is a liquid, the fluid that are between the gingiva and the teeth or the implant. In this case, I'm a surgeon and I'm an implantologist and I work with implants. In this case, we have to take a sample with the peri-paper strip. To introduce it between the gingiva and the teeth or the implant, we take the sample of this fluid. We use the periotron machine to evaluate the quantity of volume that we have in this paper. And then we can analyze the cytokines that have in this paper. If we have a higher levels of this fluid volume, it's going to be reflected in the machine, in the periotron, with a higher level of the periotron levels, we are going to have more problems, more periodontal activity, and more risk of peri-implant disease. And we are going to make an early and preclinical diagnosis with this machine and with the evaluation of the clavicular fluid. Sometimes we don't observe a mucositis or similar, but maybe it's starting the problem in a subclinical area parameters. And with this machine and with this protocol, we can find these subclinical problems. There are a lot of papers in the literature that observe that when we have higher levels of volume of clavicular fluid, we are going to have more problems of gingivitis or periodontitis. And when we have more levels also of this volume, we are going to have more bacterial plague and bacterial load of this problem. And also have a big relationship with the bone loss around the teeth and the implants. And also, there are some studies that observed that after the periodontal treatment, they are going to reduce the levels of clavicular fluid. It's a big relationship. It's a good parameter for maybe some studies. It's important to understand that it's not the same a teeth than an implant. In the tooth, we are going to have dental tissue. The connective tissue is perpendicular to the tooth, and we have the vascularity throughout the periodontal ligament. In the implant, it's a metal, can be damaged with the cleaning of the neck of the implant. The connective tissue is parallel to the implant, is a lower or not better barrier in the coronal area of the implant, and have less vascularity and do not exist periodontal ligament. With the implant, we have more problems, and we need to maintain better the oral hygiene and avoid the problem for the mucositis and perimplantitis. We made some years ago this paper, 9 years ago. It's a review of the literature that we evaluate the literature of the cytokines and the perimplant disease. We observed that the more studies were interleukin 1 beta and interleukin 6 that are more involved with the bone loss around the implants. And also observed that the cytokines concentration increases with the pathology and decrease with the after the treatment. It was the big conclusion. And it's important for study this. We started to make some papers, some studies, as you can see here, one more paper of our department, where we take from 34 patients with 213 implants. We analyze 90 implants, and we take a sample of bacteria and the clavicular fluid volume. And after study it, we observe the relationship between them. If we have more bacteria charged, this pathological bacteria, we have more volume of clavicular fluid. We demonstrate this relationship between the bacterial load and the clavicular fluid volume. If we speak about the etiopathogenia of the perimplant pathology, it depends on the situation of the perimplantary tissue. The implant design is very important, the neck of the implant. The bacteria colonization of the area, as you can see in the video, it's important that start to accumulate the bacteria around the implant and make a mucositis and start the problems. Then the oral hygiene of the patient is very important. As you can see here, the design of the prosthesis is very important because it's a bad design are going to accumulate some food. And we want to avoid the accumulation of food in the area for avoiding mucositis, as you can see in the photo. Also, the tobacco is very important. If the patient is a high smoker, we want to have very high levels of problems of perimplantitis, and we have to treat it. And the probiotics after the surgery treatment is a good option. When we made the literature review 10 years ago, we observed that there were not any paper about the probiotics in dental implants, and we decided to do this, and my PhD was about probiotics in dental implants. It was my PhD. We started with 36 patients with 228 implants, and then we increased the sample to 54 patients with 344 implants. All the patients were edentulous without teeth. We wanted to avoid the translocation bacteria from the teeth to the implant. And we made a big study of 15 months of follow-up, where we combined it with the 1 month of treatment, then 1 month, then 6 months of wash up for across the patients, and the same patients received the probiotic and the placebo for avoid some problems in this type of study. Summarizing, I don't want to explain all the protocol of the study. We made two groups, one group with healthy perimplant tissues, all the implants without pathology, and the other group with the mucositis, perimplant tissues, minimum one implant with mucositis. As you can see here in the bacterial plaque and the bleeding on probing, we reduce these clinical parameters. We improve the situation with the probiotic in both groups, in the mucositis groups, and also in sometimes in the heal the people without problems of in the implants. For me, the most important are these three graphics, because subclinically we observed a reduction in the interleukin 1 beta. You can see here from pre-treatment, after treatment in the group of mucositis, and also we improved the situation in the healthy people. Not only we reduce the cytokines in the group with mucositis, also in the group of patients that have no problems, but we reduce also the cytokines. They are going to be in a better situation and more far away of the problem of mucositis. Also with the interleukin 6, we reduce the parameter in the mucositis group. There was no differences in the healthy people, but also in the interleukin 6, we observe here high reducing levels with the probiotics in the interleukin 6 in the group of mucositis, and also in the healthy group of patients have a very big difference between the pre and post treatment. We observe these reductions in the clinical parameters and also in the cytokines levels after the use of probiotics in both groups. This paper was published in the Journal of Periodontal Research, one of the most important in periodontology, as you know. And after that, we present this paper to a prize that was made in the Europedio last year, or 2 years ago, I don't remember now. And we obtained the third prize of the Sunstar Europedio prize that they made this. And it's for me an honor to have this prize in our department. Regarding the probiotics and the mucositis and perimplantitis, there are a lot of papers now. The first one was my paper, was the first paper published indexed in PubMed regarding probiotics and dental implants. I explained it to you. We improved all the clinical parameters and also the cytokines. And there are other papers also. We are going to remark some of them. Other papers, for example, Galofre, in 2 years ago, they made a study. It was the first study with probiotics and the first study that evaluated the effect of the probiotics in the mucositis and also in the perimplantitis. We also evaluated in our first study, but we don't publish this information because it was very difficult for Thai to publish a paper with the probiotics in implants. In this case, they were supported with our paper and they made this study with perimplantitis and also with the Lactobacillus reuteri, improved the situation, reduced the clinical parameters and reduced the Porphyromona gingivalis. Also, in the study of Lauritano last year, it's not a big sample. They recommend they have to increase the sample with 10 patients with mucositis. They give Lactobacillus reuteri to the patients and observed better results in microbiological parameters, but not with significant differences. But maybe if they increase the sample with more patients, so that can observe more differences. That they explain it that they need to increase the sample. Some other papers do not obtain any good results. For example, a study of Hanstrom is the same author that in the periodontal problem also do not obtain any result. Now in implants the same. They observed in 49 patients with mucositis treatment, they made the mechanical treatment and they give Lactobacillus reuteri drops and tablets, and they do not observe differences between the probiotic and the placebo in this case. Sometimes, as I explained to you, we are going to observe no differences, but we need to make more investigation. In this other study of Mongardini, 3 years ago, they made an induced mucositis. One more time, I don't like this term of induced something. One implant in 20 patients, and they made the mechanical treatment, and they give them another probiotic, Lactobacillus plantarum and Lactobacillus brevis, and they did not observe differences between the groups in the clinical parameters and in the mild to moderate preimplantitis. And sorry, it's another paper. They not observe any difference. Maybe it is because the induced gingivitis, maybe it's a low sample of 20 patients, maybe because there are another probiotics, not the Lactobacillus reuteri. I don't have experience with these other ones, probiotics. There are a lot of things that we have to take care of this. Another paper of Tada in 2 years ago, from people to mild to moderate peri-implantitis. They give a treatment with antibiotic. 3 days, the two groups improve the situation because after the treatment of antibiotics, we are going to reduce the problems. And then after that, they give them probiotic and placebo. And after 24 weeks of follow-up, all the clinical parameters and bacterial load improves in the probiotic group. We observe a good result, but in this case, they introduce the terms of antibiotics. I don't know if it's necessary. It depends of your patient, of the peri-implantitis. Maybe it's a good idea to combine 3 days of antibiotic and then give the probiotic. It's a good option and alternative. Finally, there are another paper of Peña, the group of José Narti in Barcelona. 50 patients, it's the same group that Galofre studied. They made a mechanical treatment. They give the chlorhexidine. They wait for the disappearance of the chlorhexidine, and they give them the Lactobacillus reuteri, and the test and the control reduce the clinical and the microbiological parameters, and there was no differences with the use of probiotics. It's in this case, one more time, in the first study, they observed a good result in the peri-implantitis. In this case, they do not observe any result in the mucositis in the same group. Sometimes it can occur. I remark that it's important if you combine the chlorhexidine and probiotics, as we explained before. You have to remain some time between the chlorhexidine and the probiotics. If not, we are not going to obtain the same result. Okay, I introduced this paper that was published just at the end of the last year. It's also from Winty Walls. We made a meeting in December last year, making a round table about probiotics with Tewels and Kirinen. And this paper just was published the same week that we were there or similar. And I introduced it now here. They observe some clinical parameters and microbiological samples. They give to the patient some drops in the peri-implantitis areas. And also 24 weeks, one tablet every 12 hours. It's a big long-term treatment. They observe a reduction in the plaque index at the level of the implants and a reduction in the full month at levels of the bleeding and probing. But they are not sure of the effect of the drops and maybe the tablet. It's difficult to find the way of the drops in this case. But we observe a good result also in the paper. But finally, they recommend that it's not. We need more papers to make a protocol with the problems of the implants, and we have to improve the investigation and to have more papers about this. For the mucositis, we recommend 2 tablets every day at minimum of 4 weeks, and 1 tablet every day at minimum of 4 weeks for the follow-up. Maybe in the active phase, 2 tablets every 4 weeks, and for the control and for prevent the mucositis, 1 tablet during four weeks. We are going to improve the clinical parameters, decrease the bacteria, cytokines levels, etc. And can we use the probiotics in the peri-implantitis treatment? Yes, at first we have to follow this summarized protocol of Francois and Becker. In red, the areas that it's very difficult to regenerate, to restore the bone in this area, when we don't have a wall of the implant or the bone in the implant, we have a problem to restore it. When we maintain the wall of the bone around the implant, it's a better situation, and we can make a bone regeneration in the red areas and not in the red areas. In the green areas, we can do it, the bone regeneration. In the red one, it's more difficult. But maybe you can observe that we can do it in some clinical cases that I'm going to expose you now. If we have a vertical bone loss, it's not possible to restore this. It's very difficult. Maybe some clinicians can do it, but it's very difficult. We can use for the cleaning of the implant the tooth, the teeth brush. It's a brush for the implants. It's from titanium. and is better than the curettes. You can see here the a study that they compare the use of the T-brush compared with the normal curettes. You can see here the difference in the microscope. This is the T-brush. And now I'm going to show you some clinical cases with the use of the probiotics and the bone regeneration around the implants. Here we have this patient with a bone loss around the implant. We have a proving dip of 12, maybe 13, I don't know, very big. We open a flap, we have to clean all around the implant. Then we use the T-brush for clean the surface of the implant. And after it's clean, we apply some probiotic drugs around the implant. We made a bone regeneration with the easy graft crystal. It's also a biomaterial that has hydroxyapatite with phosphato trigalkylation phosphate and the PLGA. The PLGA is a cover for the sphere that have an action that all the particles are going to be added between them and remain stable the graft in the area. And also one more time, we cover this with the probiotics. We put a membrane, put more probiotics. There are no papers about the useful of probiotics in the perimplantitis surgery in this case, but maybe it's a placebo for me, but it's not very difficult for me to apply the probiotic drops. It's more difficult than surgery, but I do it. We close and cover it. We wait for the healing, 1 month of follow-up. Here are 7 months after the surgery, where you can see we restore all the bone around the implant. We have less than 3 millimeters of probing dip in the both implants with the control torque. And here the final crown restoration. And for me, this is the most important picture before and after 1 year of surgery. You can see that we have a 3/3 of bone loss till here in the implant, and now we restore all the bone around the implant. Maybe it's because of the probiotics, I don't know. Maybe I think there is a combination between the good cleaning of the implant and the hard tissue and soft tissue around the implant, the probiotic effect, the bone graft that we made, the membrane, the maintenance of the patient. There is a lot of factors that produce this good result. For sure that the probiotics is going to improve the situation, I don't know, because there are no papers, but I do it. I do it in a lot of clinical cases. Here I'm going to expose you one more clinical case because we spend more than 50 minutes now. And this is a part of a course that I have 3 hours, or 2-3 hours with more clinical cases, but it's only a sample to demonstrate that the good protocol, we can improve the situation. This other patient have this situation with no problems in the mandible with the implants, but some years later, after the follow-up, appear a bone loss around this implant. We open a flap, we have mucositis and perimplantitis. We don't have the buccal plate. We can see here that we don't have the buccal plate. With this drill, we clean the bone around the implant. With this, we can eliminate the soft tissue. Then we clean with other T-brush, a different T-brush, the surface of the implant. Then we apply the probiotics drops around the implant. And then we made this, the Sasha's technique of Isvan Urban, where we put some pins in the lingual area. Then we mix autogenous bone with xenograft. We put in the lingual, occlusal and buccal area and close it with the pins and making a big tension in this area for obtain a good result of the regeneration. You can see here the same. We close it without tension. And here when we reopen, we obtain a good quality of bone around the implant. We have to discover the bone upper in the upper area of the implant. This is a previous situation. And at the end, before restore with the prosthesis, you can see here the area that we restore. We want it, we want to restore this. This is 1 year of follow-up without problems, and 2 years of follow-up without problems and remains stable the bone around the implant. we solve the problem. Now that this patient, till this problem, is taking probiotics every day. I don't know if they can make a stop, maybe yes or not, I don't know. But he preferred to take only a probiotic, one tablet every day, to avoid have more problems and have to make one more surgery than the other one that we had to make for restore the bone because of the perimplantitis. In this slide also is for special situations, like in the patient with radiochemotherapy, patients with local advanced nasopharyngeal treatment with radiochemotherapy, with in 99 patients with an incidence of severe oral mucositis in grade 3 or higher, in this paper they give them probiotic treatment for enhance the immune response, and they reduce the severity of the oral mucositis through the modification of the gut microbiota. This is very important because with the oral probiotics, we not only are going to improve the oral cavity situation of the patient in a normal problems like a periodontitis or caries. In this paper that was published just 1 year ago, in this worst situation of oral mucositis is from the oral mucosa, not the implant. Oral mucositis is very difficult for the treatment, is more uncomfortable for the patient, is painful for them. And with the probiotics, they are going, as you remember the mechanism of action, we are going to enhance the immune response of the patients. And in this case that they have this situation with the radiochemotherapy, they are going to produce and reduce this, the severity of this problem, and they are going to modify the good microbiota. I think this is a good option if the patient arrives to your dental office and have this problem. Sure, that is not a normal situation, but maybe it can appear in your life of dentist. If they have this problem with the oral mucositis and you recommend and prescribe the probiotics, it's very simple for you and you are going to change the life of your patients. I think that it's important to take care about this. Finally, I'm going to put 2 minutes of this video where to explain the effect of the probiotics. We have this patient with no problems in the gingiva, in the bone levels it's okay, no problems. As you know, we have different types of implants with different neck of implant, the polished neck, the raw surface, the mechanical surface in the neck of the implant. And we know that when we have bone level implants, we have to be more careful because the bone loss can affect more quickly if we have bacteria in the neck of the implant. If the patient start to accumulate bacteria around the implant, I'm going to create a mucositis, and are going to increase the volume of clavicular fluid volume, as you can see here, and compare with the other side, and start to have a bone loss around the implant. The bacteria comes from the implant to the clavicular fluid volume, and then come inside the soft tissue, broke the bacteria, the soft tissue, and the macrophages recognize the bacteria and segregate the cytokines, the interleukin 1 beta and TNF alpha, go to the next vessels, and change this for the neutrophils go outside from the vessels and arrive to the macrophage following the way that remarks the interleukin 8, as you can see in the video. Also, the macrophages are going to make a delivery of interleukin 6. These cytokines are going to be delivered to the sulcus in the fluid clavicular volume, where we can take a sample with the periopaper strip. And also, sorry, one moment. And also, I went to the interleukin 6 goes directly to the liver and produce the PCR. The PCR in normal situation is okay for the body, but when it's higher from 2 picograms per milliliter, you're going to increase the problems of plaque atheroma plaques in this area, and we can have a heart attack of the patient. And for avoid it, we can take a probiotic. Also, they have to make a tooth bruise and then reinforce the situation with the probiotic. They are going to take it, they are going to colonize the area, and they are going to create this biofilm around the implant. The bad bacteria cannot come inside to the mucosa of the patient. And we are going to cover and to avoid the bacteria colonize the patient. We are not going to have bacteria plague, we avoid the mucositis, and we are going to avoid the perimplantitis with this treatment. We are going to don't have problems in the oral cavity, don't produce interleukin 6, don't produce PCR, and don't have a teroma plaque in our patient. We are going to make a restoration in all the body of the patient with this complementary treatment. I want to put this picture because for me it was a pleasure in December to have the meeting room, the round table with Wintiwes and Kirinen. 10 years ago, I started to study the papers, and now we made a consensus together. We started to work together. For me, it was an honor to share this table with them, and for sure that in the future we are going to make more papers together, maybe, I don't know, and improve the papers about the probiotics in the oral cavity, and in my case, in the useful for dental implants. In these days, I want to remember some people that are fighting for us in the hospitals. This is my sister that is working in the hospital fighting with the coronavirus. As sure that you have more friends that are in the hospitals or family members working hard to avoid it, for sure that we are going to not have any problem in the future, but now they are fighting for us, and I want to remember this. If you have any question, is the moment. I give you here my information. My website is now in construction. They are changing some things, but you can follow me if you have any things in my social media, like Facebook or Instagram. This is my professional Instagram. There are two. The personal is only for my family and friends. And this other one with dr.dr.tonyflitzy for clinical cases where I can expose some papers, some things. It's for professional colleagues, for share my work. I normally work about bone reconstruction and biomaterials and bone blocks, ATC, and I share it in this Instagram account. And also I put some papers, some references of papers that are important for our practice. I finalize it. If you have any question or something, I think that is the moment. I want to check chat. Josephine. Do probiotics work on the plaque index? Yes, as I explained to you, we can reduce the plaque index. In some papers, for the periodontal treatment, and also in peri-implant treatment. And which evidence is the force period between chlorhexidine and probiotics, such as that? I don't remember another paper. We made it 2 years ago. We made guidelines with some microbiological people from Sanstar, and it was the timing that they recommend in this when we have a low concentration of cytokines, 0.06%, not 0.12%, 0.06%, to wait these 4 hours, because they understand that in these 4 hours is reduced the effect of the chlorhexidine. But one more time, I recommend not to combine the chlorhexidine and the probiotic. I recommend to use the probiotic daily, or to use the chlorhexidine, wait during 1 week, for example, or 2 weeks, I don't know, and then start with the probiotics 2 days before for have more some probiotics in the moment of the we have to take out the chlorhexidine. You have to understand that it's not simple, it's difficult, because there are not too much papers about this. And we try to make some guidelines for you that is easier for follow up. But sometimes we have also some doubts about something, no? But this is the actual protocol. Do you think a diet rich in probiotics can have the same effect as tablets? I don't know, because as I explained to you, the most important is the strength of the probiotics. If we introduce probiotics in our diet, sure that we can improve in something, maybe in the stomach, but there are any study of these probiotics in the oral cavity? I don't know. I prefer to focus the effect of the probiotics with the papers that are in PubMed that I can evaluate it and can demonstrate it. But maybe yes, I don't know. There are some other probiotics that have different effects. I try to support my protocol in the evidence of the literature. If I have to prescribe to my patients, I prefer to know that there are some papers that reinforce my theory and my prescription that say that they have to eat probiotics because I don't know. You say that the patient should take the tablet 30 minutes after toothbrush. Yes. Can the patient take it right after brushing, or is mandatory to wait 30 minutes? We explain these 30 minutes to take it after that because sometimes the elements, the product that wear the toothbrush can interact with the probiotic. And I prefer to wait these 30 minutes. It's not my recommendation, it's the recommendation of the specialist that know about the toothpaste and the effect that can have with the probiotics. Maybe can use it after the toothbrush, maybe, I don't know. But they recommend that because of the effect that the toothbrush paste, no, the toothpaste, wait these 30 minutes. It's not very difficult. I do it, I clean my teeth after dinner, and maybe 30 or maybe 1 hour later, I take the probiotic. It's not the most important. But the most important is follow up and more than 2 weeks, 3 weeks taking the probiotic for obtaining this result and this biofilm around the oral cavity. Which kind of probiotics can we use to treat the peri-implantitis without an open flap, but only to inject probiotics in the pocket? I am dental hygienist. Thanks for your question. In Europe, I don't know if in other countries, not in Spain, we don't have it, maybe in other countries you have the probiotic drops of Prodentis. Here in the webinar, Sunstar organized this, and PerioBalance is a product of this Lactobacillus reuteri that the manufacturer is BioGaia. BioGaia have the tablets and also the drops. In Asia, they have also these drops, Prodentis. In Europe, we have the Protectis. I think that is for the children, for the stomach. The Prodentis is the one that I use it. I asked to BioGaia, they send me, and I put around the implant in the pockets. It's not necessary to open a flap. You can put the probiotic drops in the pockets. But at the moment, there are no literature that reinforce that it works better than only the tablets. As you remember the papers of Winty Wells last year, they use it in the periodontal pockets in the teeth, and they do not observe a good difference. And also in the paper of some months ago that also put the probiotic drops and maybe it's better than the tablet. I don't know, we need a protocol, we need to make more papers about this and how to use it. I use it because I think that it's not a problem for me to apply the probiotic drops and maybe we obtain better results. The most important is the tablet, to reinforce the tablet. And if you want to use the probiotic drops, you can put it, I do it, around the implant to reinforce the situation. I don't put the full presentation because it's bigger. Where I recommend, it depends on the bone loss around the implant. I recommend 3-4 drops in each area. And also in the maintenance, all around the implant, 2-3 drops around the implant inside the pocket for the maintenance in the people that have a high risk of peri-implantitis. But one more time, I don't know if in Europe, I mean Spain, and I don't have it. In Europe, I don't know if you have these probiotic drops of Prodentis. One more question. How long does a patient need to hold the probiotic pill inside the mouth to get the protection for the implant? You remember the guidelines, the table that I put. I recommend for the active moment, when you have the problem, at minimum 2 tablets during between two or four weeks. I prefer 4 weeks, 2 tablets. And then for the maintenance, for avoid the mucositis, with 1 tablet during 4 weeks is enough. We don't need 2 tablets every day. It depends on the risk of the patient. If we have a patient that don't have good oral hygiene, then it's a higher smoker. Don't follow the protocols. Maybe it's okay to give them always 2 tablets every day, 1 in the morning, 1 in the night, and it's okay. But for a normal patient, for the maintenance, 1 tablet every day is enough. And they can continue with the treatment without problem. Who recommended a 12 weeks treatment? Who can you recommend this in spite of evidence in the 3 weeks periodontal treatment? I don't understand very well the. We recommend in which treatment in the periodontal treatment. Okay, it depends on the periodontal treatment. All the recommendations that I made is based in the papers that I exposed to you before. If we follow the protocol of doing T-wells in the advanced periodontal problems, we recommend 2 tablets during at least 12 weeks. This is because we increase to 12 weeks. Sometimes it depends on the prognosis of the patient. We can reduce maybe at 8 weeks, but if I follow strictly the protocol of the paper of Wynn T-wells, it's 2 tablets every day during 12 weeks because it's demonstrated that it works. Maybe you observe clinically better results at 8 weeks and you can stop to 2 weeks, for example. But in these cases, normally I think that it's better to continue with the treatment at least 12 weeks and then you can remain with 1 tablet every day after the 12 weeks. And there are evidence in 3 weeks periodontal treatment in the moderate, immediate to moderate periodontitis. It depends on the grade of the problem. If you have an initial to moderate periodontitis, you can do it 3 weeks, but we recommend, well, the papers recommend at least 4 weeks for better results. I think that is not a problem. The box of the probiotics is for 1 month. You can say, okay, take it 1 month when it's finalized, come here and you can check it. Would you recommend probiotics for patients with autoimmune disease, lichen planus? At the moment, the probiotics are considered that like a dietary complement, diet complementary. It's not described any problem between these probiotics and the lichen planus, for example. Maybe some there are any. I don't see any paper and any contraindication of probiotics in this type of patients. I think that is not a problem. It's only for a local area for colonized mucosa, and at the moment don't have any problems. I have patients with some this type of problems. I give them the probiotics, and at the moment I don't have any problem. Do you think the SRP is always relevant in combination with probiotics? Do you know how long the probiotics in case of problem stays in the pockets? I don't know. If you made this treatment, I think that is important to combine with the tablet probiotics, as you can see also in the paper of Wynn T-wells. It's okay and relevant to combine it. The probiotic drops, I don't know how many times remain in the area. It's difficult for understand it. Maybe this is a problem of the study that they don't find good results because you put one time and then disappears quickly. I know that when you put the probiotics inside the area, it's going to remain some time in the cerebellar fluid, and with the time it's going to go outside of, for sure. But the most important is to create this. The most important is that the drop, the probiotic, have enough time to create a biofilm in this inside area where the tablet cannot come inside. If we colonize this area with probiotics, with the drops, and create a biofilm inside the pocket, this is the idea. How many times it's inside? I don't know. They need more studies. There are not too much studies with the probiotic drops. We just start to make something with Wynn T-wells. For sure that we need more to make more papers, but I think that you have the most important, you have to understand that to make a paper, to make an investigation, it takes a lot of time. I started with my study in 2008. I started the study and I published the paper in January of 2015. I take a lot of years to make the full study with a big sample, with a big follow-up. Sometimes less than 2 years is not possible to make a study, to evaluate the results and to publish the paper. At least 2 years. Sure that in the future I want to have more papers about this and we can improve the information and evaluate different situations, for sure. But we need time, it's difficult sometimes. Would you recommend probiotics patient? is it also okay to use for high levels athletes? I don't know the word athletes. Doping problems. I don't know. I don't know the in the athletes if they have problems with the doping. As I explained to you, it's a diet complementary. I think that will not have any problem with the doping. I never do any question about this first time. I can ask to the manufacturer if they have any problem with this site. I don't know. Really, I don't know. I think that don't have to have any problem in this case because we give them, we create a biofilm, it's a bacteria like other bacteria, and I think that is not a problem. Okay. How long does a patient need to hold the probiotic pills inside the mouth to get the protection for the implant? The same question I answered before. Is it a pill to solve in the saliva or dilution? Yes, it's a pill to solve in the saliva. You have to put in your mouth and dissolve in it and with the saliva and start to colonize the area. You don't have to come inside and to masticate. No, you have to wait for to solve in the saliva. Yes. At the moment, I don't know if the question is there any contraindication with probiotics? At the moment, I don't know any contraindication with the probiotics. Sure that if the patient have any problem with the stomach or some pathologies, you have to make an interconsultant with the doctor. But at the moment, I don't find any problem. As I explained to you, it's considered like a dietary complement. And when you have a complementation of your diet, it's not a medicine, it's not a problem. I don't say that it's impossible, I don't know. At the moment, it's not described any problem. Are probiotics recommended in gum and before tooth scaling with the sample gingivitis protocols? Normally, the protocol is to make the scaling and then to give them the probiotics. I don't know within simple gingivitis protocol. I don't know the question very well. The protocol in gingivitis is to give them the probiotics to you have to make the treatment. You have to clean it and then you give them the probiotics. And if you make the scaling, the protocol that we focus with the literature is to make the tooth scaling at first and then to apply the probiotics, not before. And I recommend it, yes, and we recommend it in the gum of the patients. Okay. There are more questions. It's okay. Ah, yes. Can we eat and drink immediately after taking probiotics? Good question. It's important. I don't explain to you that we recommend to take the probiotics if it's only one tablet every day in the night after 30 minutes after the toothbrush, and because then after we do it, we are going to go to sleep and we are not going to eat and drink anything. We recommend to wait for the eat and drink anything if you take the probiotic. Normally in the morning you have to breakfast, you took your mouth, your teeth, toothbrush your teeth. Wait 30 minutes and then take the probiotics and start to work. And then you don't have to eat anything in maybe 1 or 2 hours. No, I don't know. But I recommend to wait for eat something. If you take the probiotics, then you are going to eat something and then you clean your teeth. It's not real. It's not normal. It's in the other side. You have to eat, clean your teeth, and then use the probiotic. Okay. There are more questions. Yes. Are probiotics used as adjunct therapy in your clinic? Or it's in the protocols? It depends on the patient. We have risk patients with a protocol. We give them the probiotics orally, one tablet every 4 weeks at least, and then we control. For the normal patients, we recommend it. We don't focus in yes or yes, I have to take this. But for example, a patient that have a problem that lost some teeth and we put the implants, we restore it because they have a caries, because they have a periodontal problems, and we put the implants. In these cases, these patients invest a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of physical efforts to make the surgery, to put the implants, and they have a previous problem with a caries, with a periodontal problems. As you know, the people that have periodontal problems, when we put the implants, we have higher levels of peri-implantitis. It's reinforced with the literature also. Normally, in these patients that have a periodontal problems, I recommend yes or yes as a protocol, as an adjunct, as a complementary treatment of the toothbrush and soft pick or different kind of hygiene of the implants, to use the probiotics, because they invest a lot of time, a lot of efforts, and I know that it's a high level risk of develop peri-implantitis. In some other patients that only with a caries have this problem, I recommend it, but not too much strict than, for example, with the periodontal patients. Okay, there are any other more question? Yes. Can probiotics interfere with any chronic medication? At the moment, one more time, I don't find any way that have any contraindication with any medication or something similar. We have to focus that the probiotic is a dietary complement for our patients. I don't know if with all the medication that we have, we can interact in any way. But at the moment, it's not described any problem. I'm in continuous contact with the manufacturer, with BioGaia, and also with Sanstar, and they don't have any problem at the moment and don't describe any problem. Okay, any more question? There and okay, no more questions. Okay, we finalize all the questions. I'm very happy because you have a lot of questions. It's important because you have a big attention in the conference, and I hope that you learn all about the effect of the probiotics in the oral cavity. I hope this information will be useful for you for your daily practice. And you have any other things, any question, I agree to answer to you in my social media if you have any question. Okay, it's okay, Patricia, for you?
Yes, thanks everybody for joining. I hope that today's webinar was interesting for you and you could learn more about probiotics. And a big thanks also to Dr. Flicci for your collaboration. It was great to benefit from your expertise today. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. See you.